Welcome back to the Unanimous Decision Podcast. I am your host, D-Palm. Follow me on Twitter, at D-Palm66. Follow the show on Twitter, at UDPod. Follow the entire MTR Network, at the MTR Network on Twitter. It's the best place you can go to get everything you need with our unique spin. We're talking politics, we're talking comic books, we're talking television shows, movies, love advice, science, and of course, now sports. Now that you find us, make sure you don't lose us. You probably subscribe to the main MTR feed, and that's a great way to make sure you get a lot of our content. To make sure you get the most content as immediate as possible, make sure you subscribe to the specific UD Pod feed. Once you've done that, you make sure that you get all these special little episodes like this one right here, ones I'll drop without any sort of notice. Yeah, that way you get it first. The main feed, there's a lot of backlog. I've got to get in line. We've got content for days. My feed's just me. Come find us. If you like us, if you love us, make sure that you're subscribing so you don't miss a second. While you subscribe, take that extra 5 seconds. I know I'm asking a lot. I'm asking for a lot of your time, a lot of commitment, but I'm giving you, like, I think this is like episode 49. Like, this is episode, I'm not like, I know how many episodes there are. This is episode 49. I'm giving you a lot of content. Give me something back. Leave that 5-star review. What it does is, the 5-star review is a great way for us to know, one, people are listening. It's kind of lonely out here in podcast land, which is us and a microphone, so we don't actually know like who's out there. I'm not good with numbers, so I'm just the talent. I let Chris handle the stats and stuff. But so the 5-star reviews is my best way to let me know someone's listening. It's a great way for us to let advertisers know, hey, people are listening and they're engaged and they want to see more. And that's also a great job. It's a great thing for you because you get to have your words heard on the air. This week we've got our very first overseas review. If you leave a review from like Canada or another iTunes, I guess, exchange, let me know so I can find the review. Otherwise, it won't pop on the iTunes U.S. reviews when I pull them. So we've got a brand new review from Will in Toronto. Unanimous respect. This is another amazing show from the MTR Network. D-Palm covers topics with humor and intelligence, and it's become a must-listen in just a short time. Came up with the great work. Thanks, Will. And we're going to keep it up, like I said. 5-star reviews. It's a great way to get your word thrown in the air. If you've got more you want to say, more you can get off your chest, email us at udpodcast@gmail.com. It's a great way to have, you know, I got feedback from different people. I've gotten guest suggestions. I've been able to give out advice for recruiting. Don't come to me for the if I can help, I will. But don't say D-Palm said to do this. And so we're going to do it. I'm just one of many resources you should ever look to. Another way to help the show, not just giving advice, not just 5-star reviews, you're going to be shopping on Amazon. Amazon this morning, we're recording this on Saturday morning, they bought Whole Foods. We're all going to buy from Amazon everything, apparently, eventually. So make sure that you're doing it in a way that benefits something you love. Jeff Bezos is going to get your money. If you go to the MTRnetwork.net homepage and then go through our Amazon affiliate link, Bezos gets his cut. Can't stop that. But you also throw a little bit extra cash our way. It does not affect any of your pricing. It's the exact same Amazon you always go to. It's just a small way to help a show that I know you love. And now I know it, how much you love it. I do see the numbers on premium subscribers. It goes up every week. Thank you so much. Premium's $8 a month. Gives you access to over 300 additional podcasts. You can get the Hell No Cupids. I know we just did the Wonder Woman and spoiled review, me and Chris. That's behind the paywall. And it's great. And thank you, DC, for not screwing that one up. That meant a lot to me. I really, 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 really do appreciate it. And the last way you can support the MTR Network, maybe, you know, you've gone premium. Maybe you do your Amazon shopping through our affiliate link. Maybe you want to say, how can I tell the world how much I love MTR? Store.mtrnetwork.net is your place where you can get it. You want to tell people you love us? Say it with your chest in a tasteful t-shirt or perhaps a lovely coffee mug. I got a coffee mug. It got here today. I'm actually thinking about, do I take it to New York Con with me, or do I just save it and just have it at my desk at work and tell no one what it is? I don't know. I'm playing it by ear right now. We're going to figure it out. Get your merch. I know it's on sale through New York Con. I think through the 20th, a lot of stuff's on sale, so make sure you're getting your hands on it as early as possible. That is the intro. That's the business of the day. Why are we here today on the eve of New York Con? Well, I got to be honest. I had to talk about the Warriors. And, you know, we do an episode called LeBronukah. People start to assume certain things about you that, like, say you're a, I think the phrase is Stan. And I've never thought about myself because I don't consider myself even a fan. I just think I appreciate greatness. And, yeah, we're going to talk about that today, but we've got some other things to knock out. First, in the world of sports, so the NCAA is back. And they've had some wins lately. I'm not going to lie. They've done some things where you're like, you know what? The NCAA kind of stepped up. They kind of sent a message. They did things on the right side of history a little bit. But now we've got this story. So the UCF kicker, his name is Donald De La Haye. He has been running a YouTube account. He's published 41 videos over the last year. He's got over 54,000 subscribers and nearly 2 million views. Pretty big account. Pretty good deal. His account is basically like the life of a college athlete. Some of the things that we always say we want to know more about. He's not very explicit, I don't think, but maybe 2 or 3 mentions of where he goes to school and what he actually does. But you can see him do kicking drills, kind of live his life, and people are intrigued by it. He's found something that he's passionate about, something that he cares about, and because he's profiting from ads placed on his videos on the channel homepage, NCAA has determined that he's profiting off his own likeness and said that he has to stop. His latest video is entitled "Quit College Sports or Quit YouTube." I've linked it in the show notes. I'm going to read a quick excerpt from some of the things here. When the people at UCF compliance office told him that he was violating NCAA rules and by crafting videos that make it obvious he's a student athlete. "It's really tough. I'm not doing anything wrong. I'm not making any money illegally. I'm not selling dope. I'm not kidnapping people or robbing people. I'm not selling my autographs for money. I'm not sitting here getting Nike cleats and Nike deals and all those sponsorships. I'm literally filming stuff. I'm sitting here editing things on my computer for hours, developing my own brand. I put in the work and I'm not allowed to get any benefits from my work. Basically, I'm not allowed to make any money off my YouTube videos. I'm working hard, basically like a job, filming, editing, coming up with ideas, doing things of that sort. And I'm not allowed to make money, and I'm not allowed to make any money if I do bad things happen." He goes on to intimate that he is using some of the money to help his family back home. He's from Costa Rica, saying they had bills and he's helping out. And I don't know if it's because I, too, am a content creator. I don't know if it's because I played college football and I tend to side with the players. Or maybe it's honestly just because I'm a decent fucking human being. This is ridiculous. I'm sorry. I'm not sorry. I'm not sorry at all. This kid has found something. While fulfilling all his obligations as a collegiate football player, while acting as an agent of the school to bring eyes and wins and dollars to that institution, he found something that he's truly passionate about, something that he could actually, you know, maybe make a career out of after college. And the NCAA said, "Hey, you're making money for likeness. Only we can do that." This is why I use the image of the EA check I got a couple years ago as one of our earlier cover images for the show. It was a check. It was fine. But it showed the paltry amount they actually say that your image is worth. And if we're worth that little, I gotta ask, why is this YouTube page such a threat? And the answer, of course, is it's not. And the likeness is worth more. And NCAA, main goal in life, as we've always said, it's to keep them broke. But to tell a kid who's found, and let me vouch for him. If he's doing all the things he said, if he's filming himself, editing himself, booking ideas, if he has a couple guests on, if he books guests, take it from me, it's hard work. It takes time. It takes energy. If NCAA to say, no, you're doing this purely for profit, I don't know what the ad split looks like at YouTube, but I guarantee it's not that good. He's not caking like that. But hey, that's what NCAA decided to do. You're going to hear a follow-up story in a couple weeks. Probably where the NCAA said they're going to be the heroes. And that's the one's going to make the headlines. NCAA relaxes rules on burgeoning YouTube star. You have all these quotes and they'll cut out the part where they told him to stop. How many families... have to throw themselves at the altar of the NCAA claiming fake amateurism so that maybe, just maybe, they can see their sons play. Or maybe, just maybe, you can go home when the people are sick. They'll violate you for that. If a coach plays for your flight home when your mother's sick, I've seen violations for that. Everyone who watches college football, college basketball, I'll always ask them, what does the NCAA actually do? Only four schools. Nah, man, that's actually done by and large on a conference level. Like a drug bust, you won't see the NCAA dropping down on a kid who got weed. It's when they think you're getting kids paid, or when they think that you're circumventing them as a school. If you're circumventing the established power structure, that's when they hit you. Beyond that, what's the NCAA do? Tweet me at dpalm66 or at udpod. I am serious. This is a serious question. What does the NCAA do beyond those two things? Beyond those two things and put out press releases, the conference is handling alone conference games. And now, with college football, we've seen the NCAA does not need to be involved in the championship decisions. The question remains, what does the NCAA do? Not all the news this week was bad, because the Olympics bringing in 3-on-3 basketball. Now, I know what some people are saying. This is fake sports. This is a denigration of the Olympic ideals. And I say to you, for shame, my friends. Because you know the most fun I have not during any Olympics, but one of the most fun times you can have during Olympics is finding the sports where you're like, you know, give me 3 years and a budget. I could probably make the next Olympic game. For me, that game is curling. Every time curling's on, I gotta be sitting with my friends, like a bar or something, or be in someone's house, like, you're like, if we got together and took, like, every Saturday for the next 3 years, we could be pretty good at curling. Like, I think we could do this. And we don't do it because we have no follow through, because we're lazy millennials. But that's what I think 3-on-3 could be for for the world. I don't think they're gonna do pros. Like, pros aren't gonna do this, which is exciting. Because I do want to see the average man compete, and I do want to have that, like, average man hope. Like, I want to see just 3-on-3 hoopers, like the old Atlanta running shoot, like that. I want to see those crews competing for a spot to represent for America. Part of me does want to see LeBron, Steph, and Carlton Towns go through and destroy the world. But I could definitely live with, like, you can... I hope the rule is, like, you never play college basketball. Like, if that's... the bench line, and no NBA, obviously. Like, if the kids who skip, nah, you're out too. But, like, if you've never played beyond a high school level organized basketball, like, that's where I'm at. Semi-pro, can't play. Sorry. Well, I did a couple years in Spain. Well, then you're not playing in this. That's what I want. I want individual satellite tournaments to be aired on ESPN2 with the old school ESPN2 logos. Only at, like, 3 in the morning, too. And I want you to air them. I'll watch every second. Just like these satellite feed in from Beijing is the first round of, like, however many teams, like 128. You can do this is like a 3-year event. NBC, call me. I just made this awesome money. I got this. Anyone who tells you this is bad for the Olympics or bad for basketball, those people hate fun and should be removed from your life immediately. The Warriors weren't the only team to capture championship this weekend, or this past week, I should say. The Pittsburgh Penguins. Yo, how did that whole city pull off the, like, high school team colors thing? Every time I think about it, I'm like, that's kind of dope. Like, it's not the coolest thing in the world, but, like, all of them having the same color scheme, I like the city unity. You can never do it in a real city, but Pittsburgh pulls it off. The Penguins have won back-to-back Stanley Cups under a hard salary cap. And, like, I am the most casual. I go above casual, but I am a very not serious hockey fan. This hard cap is a beast. I've watched it tear apart cup teams like that. Like, the Blackhawks winning 3-6 a whole. It's a different type of crazy and weird and impressive. But back-to-back cups is designed not to happen. For those of you who say, I like the NBA, but I want more parity. Hockey's your sport, 82 games, and anyone can win anything at any time. Nashville came in as the 80. They're the last team in the playoffs. Knocked out the Blackhawks. Fought their way through. Pushed a defending Stanley Cup champ with possibly a top 5 all-time player. Because I'm sorry, right now, back-to-back cups, Crosby's got to be on your list. He's got to be on your list. You take the worlds, you take his golds in the Olympics. Like, Sidney Crosby, he's not Gretzky. No one ever Gretzky. He's not Orr. He's not Gordie Howe. But, like, after that, I'm like, oh, let's... And I don't want to be the dude who's the prisoner of the moment, but let's have a conversation, because Messier? Lemieux? Like, the Lemieux thing is... Because Lemieux means so much to this team. I think his legacy is bolstered by what he's done post-retirement, post-second retirement. But it's a conversation to have, and I think the fact that we're living in an era where Crosby's made that leap is both impressive and great, and I think it's fun to watch. But you look at guys like Alex Ovechkin, who like you're like, maybe you're Ewing. Like, maybe you were just born in the wrong decade. Like, it just wasn't meant to be. Like, you have a fine career. You're all-time great. Maybe not you. Maybe he's better than you. Maybe he's Barkley. Maybe he's Karl Malone. You worked, not Karl Malone. Ovechkin, I haven't been insulting Ovechkin like that. Sorry, Cavs fans. I didn't mean to do that. But I'm just saying, like, this is the presence of greatness. Tip the cap. And, yo, Nashville, man, I'm cheering for them to figure out a way to hold the team together through these cap restrictions. Because even if you don't like hockey, you heard this story about how this team came together, how this city embraced this team, embraced this sport, how Sun Belt hockey, they say, could never work, and how Nashville proved them all wrong, man. I want to go to a Preds game next year. We got listeners in Nashville. Let me know. Let's do this. I'm about the Preds, man. I'm about live hockey. And Nashville's a great town. And I think that they've been embracing this sport and this team. I hope it carries on if the team falters. But if it's one or two seasons of magic, that counts too. That counts too. It matters. No one's going to forget it. All the kids that grew up around this will never forget this. Let's talk about why we're all here. Tragically, LeBronukah was cut short this year. Only got to celebrate for 5 nights. But it was still a very happy LeBronukah in many ways. And I'm going to talk about the Warriors first. Because that's the lead story. It should be, right? That should be the lead story. The Warriors did it again. They put it together when they needed to. They turned it on. They closed out the Cavs in 5 on their home floor. Draymond got to wear a disrespectful shirt and be real disrespectful towards King James on the float. Whatever, he earned it. You can be disrespectful because they got it. And you tip the cap. There's nothing you can say. Like, this is a dominant, this is a run you've never seen before. This is 16-1. This is, and not against like an overmatched Sixers team. This is a 16-1 against arguably the greatest player of all time. And for all the things they say, like, oh, because they lost, they got Durant. They were getting Durant win, lose, or draw last year. That was in the works for months. Draymond could be brought up on tampering charges. That's from all the stories I heard. Like, you put them together, like, yo, this timeline, you know, Dray needs to chill. Like, it feels like tampering. But it wasn't. It's not. It's just some dudes who wanted to play together. And Kevin Durant was able to say, oh, I will walk away from a year and an additional $40 million to go move from Oklahoma to California and play with a bunch of guys who are unselfish and fun and like to shoot threes and who are already winners. And I think the commendable part about Durant is that people say, oh, he'll come and fit in. Da, da, da. He didn't come and fit in. That's Durant's team now. Don't believe me? How many times have you seen Riley Curry at a podium this postseason? Right. The pecking order is reestablished. He's not a guy who came on and grabbed some coattails. He's the one who said, looked around and said, it's a pretty good crew. Follow me. And it was weird because you saw it early in the season. I think the first 4 or 5 weeks, Steph was shooting less and kind of supplanting his game. And apparently Durant went to him and said, look, man, just do you. I'm going to fit in. Don't worry about me. I'm going to get mine, do you. And that's kind of where they hit that stride. And then it was like, oh, God, what if something happens? And then Durant got hurt for, 20 games. And they went undefeated. And you figured out that, oh, God, they built this 73-win team into something scarier. Something that has a second year. Something that has, when the things get jammed up or when things get gummed up, a player who can say, I got this. Because I think that's one of the things that really kind of defines this team and this era in basketball is that one creator is not enough. And it's always been, you've always needed three stars to win. Very few teams have ever won a title without having three all-stars. That being said, the three all-stars they had in Golden State, only one really had the ability to create on his own. When an offense broke down or when defense got ratcheted up in the playoffs, it was said, Steph, you got to create for us. And as we've seen in the last couple of finals, this guy's got two MVPs, zero finals MVPs, and zero real considerations. They had to give one to Iggy for holding LeBron to a damn near triple-double, which is the most, like, if, like, this, there's a case this year, there's a, for a losing team to get the MVP, there was a much stronger case 2 years ago for LeBron to get it. And, but now it's, you've got the second guy who can create on his own. And I can't think of any teams top of my head in the league who have two established guys who do it. Like, you've got two guys, you might have guys with potential to do it, but for guys to create on their own, it's really just the Warriors, and that's a scary thing. Because Steph, again, this postseason, kind of, or this finals, for two games, kind of went back in that shell that, yeah, I'm not really here for this bright lights, big city life. But Kevin Durant established he was. This guy, yo, he left the job for a better job. Why are we haters? Accept it, move on, it's fine. And for people who've been saying for the last 2 weeks, super teams are bad. We need parity in the NBA. And then watched the Magic Celtics or Lakers Celtics 30 for 30 and said how great it was and how, oh, that's how the league used to be and don't see the incongruities in their argument are fools. This has been a league defined by super teams, defined by dominant teams. Well, the super teams phrase apparently has become problematic this week, but as a dominant team, dominant teams have defined and created the NBA. Was Jordan bad for the league? I don't think so. Dame Lillard this week, said, they asked him about a fourth possible Golden State Cavaliers final. He said, better not be. We got to step it up, and we got to break that S up. You know why? Because greatness inspires greatness. Does John Wall establish himself as possibly the best point guard in the NBA? Without LeBron James as the steeple horse? I don't know. I do know this. That was the one thing about Jordan's legacy. He never had a rival. He never had, or he had like a series of rivals, but he never had one person pushing. That's where LeBron finds himself. He is the pace setter. How good is LeBron? He just averaged a triple-double in the finals and lost in five. The Golden State Warriors built a Hulkbuster in the form of a basketball team, and he still went for triple-double. His legacy is to a point where I think it's inassailable by finals losses, because people say, oh, he's 3-5. You know, that adds up to 8 trips, 7 in a row. 7. He's still the boss level, because there's nothing in that East that says, here's what's up and coming. Here's what's next. Remember when they told me the Celtics were? Remember when they told me the Celtics, Isaiah Thomas, was Allen Iverson and the Celtics were coming? Nope. Wrong. Who else in the East? Before we get out of here, I do want to tackle the hashtag embrace debate topic of the week. That's what ESPN says about their programming. I promise you I didn't make that up. I'm not that corny. People are trying to compare this Warriors team to past teams. And I love Steve Kerr's answer of, you know, you're right. Sports are the only place evolution works backwards. Those guys would have killed us. And the dudes from the 50s? Yo, murderers row. They beat us in 3. Because he's right. I always said this, man. Rob Rory. Kind of a journeyman. A lot of rings. Big shot Bob. Robert Horry was a power forward who could shoot threes and stood about 6'9", 6'10". If you took Robert Horry and dropped him in 1983 and looked at him like a fucking alien, they wouldn't know what to do with him. Take this year's Milwaukee Bucks and drop him in 1986. Giannis would, people's heads would explode when they saw Giannis. Explode It would make no sense to them. So, straight up, do I think that a lot of this argument is, you know, nostalgia rearing its ugly head? Yeah. Yeah, I do. The word, are there things that other teams match up from it? Of course. Stylistically, a lot of things. But I refer back to Michael Thompson, Klay Thompson's dad, member of the 89 Lakers, was on the radio this week, and he said he was about to commit some blasphemy. So I was listening. He said, threes are worth more than twos. We shot eight threes a game. They shoot eight threes a quarter, and they make more than half. What do you want me to do? Man was on the team. He knows what he's talking about. MVP of the week this week is Michael Vick. In case you aren't aware, Michael Vick was allowed to come back home to Atlanta and retire as a Falcon. And when I say home to Atlanta, this was his professional home. He went to Philly, Pittsburgh, made the trips after the dogfighting thing. But early 2000s, this city was defined by Michael Vick. We were the only team that was outlawed on Madden because of our quarterback. It was the coldest thing in the world, man. Michael Vick, he came in and it was a perfect like Atlanta moment. Like it was like Atlanta music was hot, really popping. Like he had all the football players from all the music videos because he made us care about sports. This is not a city that cares about sports. I'm too young to remember how big Neek was. Still a big deal now, but that faded. That passed. The Braves were hot when Sid slid. But by 97, you couldn't sell a playoff game. We get tired of winning. We're in the Thrashers. I'm out of here. They're the Flames now. And there have been flashes of the Falcons. Don't get me wrong. 2008, we went to Super Bowl. No one cared about that team until week 12 when they beat San Francisco. Because no one believed. They're like, yo, we're the Falcons. Things are going to go wrong. Beat San Francisco. Like, all right, maybe. And then you know when we stopped caring? The moment we stopped caring? When Jamal Anderson blew out his knee the next year. It was over. It was a wrap. Because we're back to being the Falcons. But that Vick era, man, that was the first time the Falcons were a national story, man. Michael Vick highlights, they were the highlights of the NFL weeks. You can never take away him speeding up between them two Minnesota defenders and running clean through them. You can never take that away from me. You can never take away me watching Michael Vick speed up in the open field and increase the distance between him and the trailing DB and the DB giving up. Like, there's nothing I can do. Michael Vick with the laser on his arm. He paid his dues. He did everything that we say as a nation we want you to do when you screw up. He admitted his mistake. He acted towards good and he tried to rectify it. Some people will never forgive him. That's their prerogative. Me, myself, I'm not wired that way. He did what he could. What more can we ask? Thank you, Michael Vick. I was in the dome. So I was in the dome. It was the weekend before I left for Columbia. So right before I was going to play college football for the very first time, a family friend invited us to, and if I was someone else there, I must have overstated who it was, invited us to go to the dome to watch the Falcons-Ravens preseason game. That's the game where Michael Vick broke his leg. And I was like, I got in the car the next day and drove to New York City. But it was shocking. It was the end of an era for largely for the team because it led to everything else that kind of, you know, unraveled at the end. But whew, you'd never take away Lambeau winning in the freezing weather in the playoffs, embarrassing the Rams at home in the playoffs. I would love to see Mike Vick in the Super Bowl, but I'm glad he got to see us make one that last year. That's it, guys. That's all we've got. Again, my name is D-Palm. Follow me on Twitter at D-Palm66. Follow the show on Twitter at UDPod. Follow the entire Intern Network at the Intern Network on Twitter. Subscribe to the iTunes store. Leave the 5-star reviews. Email us at udpodcast@gmail.com. And go through our Amazon affiliate link on the MTR homepage. Make sure you're going premium to get the extra content. And if you like us, if you love us, say it with your chest. Store it on MTRnetwork.net. I hope to see everyone at the NegroCon tonight. I hope also to see everyone who didn't make NeoCon at the after party. It's going to be an RFD. We should stick around until they kick us out because, you know, they got beer and stuff there. So I have no intention of leaving anytime soon. That was your show. Because, yes, Golden State did win. This is your outro. See y'all next week.